Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back. After a long 2-hour break, we have our second of four best of threes of the evening coming up for the World Esports Championship. We've got Arrow versus Invasion. I'm Zayori, now joined remotely by Blaze. What's up, Blaze?
Not too much. Been super hyped to get into this game, but you just got to keep it rolling once the Lobby Dota comes out for the SEA scene. So yeah, we've been on pause for a little bit, seeing some emoticons being spammed out and all that for a while now, but finally we get into it, and I'm actually curious to see how this will pan out. Arrow's got two stand-ins now instead of just the one. I guess Lance couldn't make it this time around, so that really does kind of change the matchup quite a bit since these teams are so close already.
Yeah, absolutely. Right now the bets are 67% in favor of Arrow, but I think that was before the bettors realized that there were two stand-ins here. So it should be an interesting series. Again, it is a best of three. And elimination on the line here. Just a quick little single limb bracket. Arrow, they had the luxury of first pick. They were docked 30 seconds of reserve time. Seems like just a minor slap on the wrist for starting 30 minutes late here, Blaze.
Yeah, I suppose so. But it's not just general lacks of administration. It's just the aspect of the players where it's very common to be starting 15, 20, 30 minutes late, and they can't afford to just like take a game away from them because it happens way too often for that, and it would just pretty much define how the games pan out. So we do start late, but you know, we get into it, and it should be pretty interesting nevertheless. Already we see a draft where it looks like a little bit of push and team fight coming up from Invasion. They generally draft either to kill towers or to kill heroes, but this kind of seems a nice mix of the two with some good disable and damage. But Arrow answering back with Faceless Void and Rubick should be pretty interesting.
Yeah, let's go ahead and reset the call. You're getting you call me this time. Let's see if that makes a difference. All right, so give us just a second here, folks. Blitz sound. I keep wanting to call him Blitz. I don't know why. Hello.
How's it going?
Good. All right, we'll see if that's any better. I keep wanting to call you Blitz, and I don't know why. I think I've just spent too much time watching Zephyr. So if Blitz pops out, just slap me across the face and say it's Blaze, goddammit, because that's my bad. Sure. I've already done it twice, and we're only five picks into the draft. So,
oh goodness.
But yeah, you sound a little better now. So, all right, right back in it. Invasion will go ahead and third pick the Viper for a little bit of lane dominance here, and we'll see how Arrow responds. We do see Tinker and Invoker banned out by Invasion with their third and fourth bans.
Yeah, that's pretty interesting, just kind of respecting DDZ's potential on those heroes. Obviously, he is the kind of all-star solo mid player of the Malaysian scene, at least of teams that are representing Malaysia, not China. But with the shuffle going down, a lot of people are trying to poach him, I heard, and they're making sure that they stay under the Arrow tag there. So still representing some strength with those high utility heroes, those ones that can just make amazing things happen with burst damage output. But there's still a lot of heroes in the pool. Like, you'll ban the Invoker and the Tinker, and that's very wise for second phase bans. But that doesn't in the slightest inhibit what he can do with any other hero. I mean, yes, Viper isn't annoying to lane against. You don't have your two heroes that do the most, but you're still going to be able to gain momentum with some incredible just use of skill. I mean, this guy is amazing. So I can't wait to see what DDZ can do with heroes other than what we know him for. But of course, the Viper, FZFC, a very strong mid laner in of himself, might be able to pin him down. We'll see.
Yep. And Arrow Gaming will switch things up a little bit with their third pick. It is indeed the Juggernaut. So a hero that's pretty good in lane, of course, kind of known for those cheeky first blood, early kill, tri-lane type setups. Also synergizes very well with pushing strats, complements of that healing ward. So with a Rubick Juggernaut, could be the makings of a killer tri-lane. But time will tell. I suppose it could be a support jug as well. We've seen that a time or two on the position four.
Yeah, I think the Faces Void offlane and carry Juggernaut's a little more common in this scenario, but it still is very plausible if they really want to emphasize the push. They need a couple more heroes to kind of reinforce that kind of a draft. Right now, they don't really have that much other than Chronosphere to team fight with. But, you know, if you get some amazing steals from Mosin on the Rubick, a Ravage or two, then that'll obviously supplement your arsenal there. So Juggernaut, still flexible in his role set, but I don't know. I'm not sold on the pick at this stage in the draft. Maybe they're just trying to kind of keep their cards hidden. I don't know, but right now, Juggernaut, he brings a lot of physical damage, but he's not going to be able to single down anybody but the Rasta just yet.
Yeah. That's a good thing to mention. The other three heroes, very, very tanky and not easy for Juggernaut to secure an early kill on with the Blade Fury. So possibly some good picks for evasion. Maybe it'll all come together with these last two picks for Arrow. But yeah, so far I'm not quite seeing all the synergy. Rubick and Jug are not heroes that particularly synergize with the Chronosphere. I mean, sure, you've got the Fade Bolt you can dump in there and you can Omni Slash into it, but not a huge amount of damage, not quite on par with something like a Tinker or an Invoker or your Skywrath or something like that. And wow, Arrow opt for the Lifestealer here. They have triple melee carries.
Yeah, this is something they're much more comfortable with. The Lifestealer pick, Lance runs this all the time. Obviously, 343 from Narastax is standing in for Lance for this game, but this draft is something that Mosin is very familiar with. You get double a magic immunity, one from the spin of the Juggernaut and one from the Rage of the Lifestealer, so Ravage is not nearly as impactful. It's also, with the Alchemist stun being so projected, so predictable, you can also avoid that quite effectively. The Hex is a little more difficult because it is instantaneous, and maybe with a Blink Dagger behind the Shadow Shaman, they can still pick one of these guys off, but Juggernaut and Lifestealer are actually really strong here for the earlier team fights when Tidehunter is at his strongest. So I like it. It is going to mean a support Juggernaut alongside the Rubick and then presumably an offlane Void.
Yeah. So that leaves the mid hero here for Arrow Gaming. What are they going to pick for DDZ?
Oh, goodness. I mean, they need something that really does add to the team fight. I don't think you can rely on Ravage Steals left and right. But they do, like you said, they have some push emphasis. So anything that can do some good damage, no matter how you put it, the tower damage, the tier damage, as long as he's very active. And that's pretty much the signature thing about DDZ in the first place. So they ban out the Wind Ranger. I think that would have been appropriate. But I'm not entirely sure what they would go with in this situation. Against the Dragonite, against Viper.
Okay. So maybe like a Puck could be okay here. Some magic damage, follow up with the Void. Nice mobile hero for the mid. I don't know. What else does DDZ play? Does he play Storm Spirit? Is that in his arsenal?
He has played Storm a decent amount of times, and with the Lifesteal, it's really, really strong.
Yeah.
So I would like that, but it just kind of depends on where they want to put. They don't want to put too many eggs in the single target basket, because they've got the Omni Slash. The Void can single somebody on a Chrono. You can definitely get a kill on one single person pretty quickly, but like a Storm jumping in isn't going to insta-gib, like I said, anybody with a Rasta. And that's going to be problematic. They're up against some tanky heroes here. Viper's got the Corrosive. Alchemist has his ultimate, which heals him up like crazy. And DK, of course, with the Dragon's Blood and a pretty high strength game. So
it'd be a good Timbersaw game, I think. I don't think he'll fit into this Arrow draft, but would have worked out well if they could have picked him up.
Yeah, not bad.
But I'm curious what they'll go for here. I don't know about the Storm Spirit pick. There are just so many stuns for invasion. It would be a rough game for a Storm Spirit, though. Still possible.
10 seconds remaining.
But I guess we'll just be patient here for the next 5 seconds.
5 seconds remaining.
Yeah, I mean, Sky... No,
there's
Timber,
the Timbersaw.
Right.
Okay. Wow.
Like 3 strength heroes, just in general mobility, survivability. He's going to be able to do a lot of work in this game.
A lot of melee in this game in general.
Mm-hmm.
Only 3 ranged heroes. Well, wow. I like the Timbersaw pick here. DDZ Timbersaw, is that something that he's pretty comfortable with?
I wouldn't say 100%. Like, he's played it a good handful of times, and I have seen him have major success with it. But that doesn't mean like it's like a walk in the park for him, as opposed to all the other heroes that he plays much more commonly. So we'll see a little bit more of DDZ's versatility here. I'm confident in the lane matchup at the very least. Like, up against a Viper or a Dragonite, Timbersaw can still do fine. With his just an incredible skill set that he can dominate the lane with. And from there, it really comes down to his team moving with him. DDZ by himself will be able to bring people down to maybe half HP, a quarter HP, but it's going to take some good communication and coordination with these stand-ins in order to really seal the deal.
All right, Blaze, are you ready for some stats? Stats man Zayori?
Sure enough.
DDZ has played Timbersaw once this year in competitive games. Once, and it was a loss in the Join Dota League 2 last month. Or no, 2 months ago. It was in June. So only one Timbersaw game. This will be a little interesting to see how he fares. He played it twice in the tail end of 2013. With both of them were wins, but that was quite a while ago. So not a hero. He's played a hell of a lot in competitive, and this will be a treat for all of us.
Yeah, I've spec'd some scrims where he has been playing it very effectively, but yeah, if it's only been one competitive game where it's actually on the line, then they must feel really confident how well the pick fits into the draft. And I agree with it. Like, the amount that Timbersaw brings to this lineup is going to be immense. Invasion, if they're down with the strength when they get hit by that Whirling Death and they just don't have the resources to bring down Timber, at least not cost efficiently, I think that he's going to be able to just kind of play with them and run circles around them if they gain some momentum.
Yep, I agree with you, my friend. Now let's introduce some rosters here. And, oh, okay. On the Dire side, we've got Team Arrow, the team with two stand-ins. We've got Zhang Zai playing on the Faceless Void here in the Dire offlane. He will be joined by Mosen playing on the support Rubick, as well as stand-in MTR on the support Juggernaut, all slated for the bottom lane. DDZ solo mid on the Timbersaw, and that leaves stand-in 343 on the Lifestealer up top.
Mm-hmm. They're going to be putting some pressure here down on bottom lane, which is composed of ADTR on the Viper, as well as OK, also known as Calm TFD, on the Shadow Shaman. Actually, probably going to get first blood if he's not too careful, but Mosen is not close enough to MTR and might not get the TK if he tangos through.
Oh, are they going to see him? They'll walk right into OK. Double damage rune onto Mosen. The Stretch Armstrong Shackles will connect on the Rubick. And Viper throws a couple of auto attacks, but Juggernaut throws out the spin. Will the first blood come out actually onto the Rubick? One more auto attack ought to do it. The poison will take him down, and the first blood comes out for FZ on the Alchemist. It's a turnaround the other way, and Invasion come out ahead.
Yeah, it was a really good shackle from OK, just preventing the telekinesis on the Viper, who was obviously their prime target in the first place, and just kind of really confusing what their focus order was. So they were able to get the first blood against the aggressive tri-lane. That means that now Zhang Zai is really going to have to be very careful how he positions himself, because the Viper gets more farmed, is able to zone him out a little bit more, and they've already got the Bassy ring for the whole team.
Yep. Very cheeky plays from OK right there. He moved into the trees and baited it out, got the shackles off, and that's what started off that engagement to go the way of the Radiant. Let's take a look at the mid lane here. Dragon Knight, I still didn't finish introducing this roster. It's Kessick Imba playing on the Dragon Knight solo mid. We've got Ghost in the offlane here on the Tide Hunter. So Tide, almost level 3. Looks like he's having an okay time. Already picked up 4 last hits. And Void, definitely going to be struggling a little bit more. Finding some experience now, but his supports have left him. They've rotated up top, and they'll try and secure some farm for the Lifestealer.
Yeah, and that's the necessary call. Unfortunately, when you feed a first blood in an aggressive tri lane that's not like automatically won by matchup alone, then you really need to rethink your strategy. So it's a good movement here. Unfortunately, they're not going to be able to control the Tide all that well. Tide is already level 3, has his boots, and a 290 MS Rubick is not going to be able to close in on a 360 MS Tide. So Ghost should be able to do what he needs to with this ward in place to survive and get to level 6 at a pretty effective time.
Yep.
And
Go ahead.
Looking at mid lane here, we're going to see smoke come through from the Alchemist, already charging up the concoction. He is going to hit onto it, but with no Dragon Tail, will it be enough damage? It doesn't look like it. DDZ, salving back up, will be pretty much full HP by the time they retreat.
Yeah, Timbersaw, not an easy gank at this stage in the game. He's got that value point in Timber Chain for some mobility, but also the point in reactive armor. So just a tanky force all around, and without that Dragon Tail, as you mentioned, kind of no way you'll secure that kill. Meanwhile, in the bottom lane, Void finding some recovery farm, actually. As the Radiant supports have rotated about, that's allowed him to be a little more aggressive here against the Viper. Now 10 CS on him compared to the 16 of Viper. So good news for the Faceless Void. He's picked up that poor man shield. So recovery is inbound, but the supports rotate their way back down bottom, and he'll be forced to play a little bit more passive. But pretty even opener out of the gate here. Invasion with a very minor lead complements that early first blood, but pretty comparable across the board. Dragon Knight, yeah, struggling a little bit against the Timbersaw, but they're within 3 or 4 CS of each other.
Yeah, I think that's going to be a little bit easier for the Timbersaw as the lane goes on to like just completely dominate this matchup, though. Like, the bottle of the magic stick, it alleviates some of the damage because Dragon Knight can just use his breathe fire to get the CS. But in general, the Timbersaw is just going to be able to harass much more efficiently with that Whirling Death as he max it. The third point, the fourth point, those are really valuable. But for right now, second point in Timber Chain is going to allow him to be a little bit longer range initiation, moving about the map a little bit more, and being more active there. And that brings me to another point where the Lifestealer synergizes really well with this Timbersaw pick. Initiating there, it's essentially an effective Blink Dagger with this Timber Chain. You find the right tree, You have a Nyx infested inside, and you're going to be able to just burst down some people before they knew what hit them. So a lot of kill potential here. We'll see if they can make use of it, maybe rotate the void into a safe lane farming position while the Lifestealer goes to gank. Not too sure.
Yep, absolutely. And Timbersaw, he's sort of an interesting hero to have in the mid lane. Usually you want to see him in a side lane because there's more trees around to abuse Timber Chain, and also it's easier to find the pure damage from Whirling Death when you're chopping down those trees. Mid, it's a little more difficult, but you get the added bonus of all of that solo experience and, of course, all of that delicious farm. He does have a haste rune bottled up, so maybe we'll see this Timbersaw move around with this haste rune and try and secure a kill once he grabs the Chakram. Or perhaps DDZ will just sit back and continue farming. His supports are inbound, though. MTR and Mosin on the high ground on the Dire side of the river. And there is a Radiant Ward on the high ground outside the Ancients, but doesn't give any vision into the darkness on the other side, so they won't be scouted out quite yet. And it looks like they will just wrap around and head bottom.
Yeah, and this is actually good timing because they just got this pull that Shadow Shaman and Alchemist really needed. Level 2, level 3, they could have benefited from it, but they're occupied while it looks like this ward's going to make their move towards mid. Ghost, first going to go for Gush, and I'll let you take from here.
Yep, Elder Dragon form pop. There's the stun coming out from the Alchemist, but they do secure the kill on the Tidehunter. The Whirling Death from DDZ just doing too much damage. Now Alchemist only level 2 in big trouble as Void comes in with the Time Walk. MTR taking a lot of damage. But it's a double kill for the Faceless Void as the Shadow Shaman gets finished off. Now Kesek Imba in trouble. Chakram will slow it down. ADTR on his way in to try and clean it up. And he will secure one kill on the Timbersaw. It's now him versus the world. A 1v3 Chronosphere comes out after the Viper Strike flies on Mosin. He'll survive the damage of the dots. But will they have the damage to bring down the Viper? Blade Fury deployed. Out comes the Acid Spray. One more auto attack on ADTR. And MTR will be forced to retreat, and he is going to fall to the poison after all. Concoction charging up, throws the stun on the Void, looking for the kill onto the Viper. Can't find it as the shackles fly and the salve comes out. They turn it around, and Viper cleans house.
Yeah, absolutely. We're going to see 343 do some damage here onto Ghost on the top lane. He's got his Midas, pretty much just showing what he can do on this lane. But that fight was actually very back and forth. At first, Arrow looked like they were just going to absolutely take it by force with that haste rune on Timbersaw. But the Giant was brought down in the end with a couple of good auto attacks from DK and Viper. So with him out of the picture, they were able to really change how it played out. The Chronosphere wasn't enough to bring down the Viper. And from there, they did return quite a few kills. So good on both sides. Now the mech's up for the Viper. And I think they're a lot more confident in a team fight, especially in a 5v4.
Yep. And that is one of the problems that Arrow will continue to have throughout this game, is Chronospheres like that, where if Void's not the one doing the damage, then I'm not sure who is, because they really just don't have a lot to dump in there. Fadebolt and Chakram are about the only two ranged nukes that you can throw easily into a Chronosphere without getting caught yourself. And I guess the Omni Slash. You can Omni Slash through Chrono, right?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yes, but I was like 99% sure, but I haven't seen it in a while.
Yeah, so, and it's a support juggernaut, so the Omni Slash isn't going to be all that effective. Like, it's going to be lower bounces and lower damage in between the slashes. So,
yeah,
all in all, I definitely think the Void is the odd man out in this draft. Like, they picked it up early in the draft because it's a very strong meta-relevant pick. But as far as fitting it in with the four melee lineup, I don't really feel it.
Yeah, completely agreed. So 4-4 here as we pass the 8-minute mark. Arrow with a very small golden experience lead of about 5-600 here. But still rather even. Any hands of Midas been picked up? Yes, 3-4-3 on that Lifestealer has been pretty quiet this game. And he'll just go Brown Boots straight into Midas in the mid lane. Kesek Imba in some trouble as he gets Telekinesis back, pops the Elder Dragon form. They don't have the damage to bring him down. Viper there with the mech will keep him alive, and they turn it around on the Juggernaut. Invasion, walk away with a 1-for-0 exchange. Now a dominating streak on this level 8 Viper.
Down the bottom, the Chronosphere will come out. We're going to see Calm go down, the Shadow Shaman. A little bit too big for his britches there, just trying to push out while his team was rotating. But I would say the better trade was on that mid lane. Now up top, 3-4-3, hammering on to Ghost. They do have the Timbersaw coming in. Will the TP come out of time? No. Oof. The burst combo from Infest and Whirling Death sealing his fate.
Yep, more than enough damage to finish him off. So nicely done from Arrow. Good rotation from the Timbersaw, but it won't come for free. This Tier 1 tower in the mid lane will take a tumble. Elder Dragon form makes it an easy push with that corrosive breath. Looking for the deny, but Mosin off the mark. Maybe Arrow can grab a Tier 1 tower in the top and at least trade Tier 1 for Tier 1, but there's a Radiant Glyph, an opportunity to TP in and look for defense, possibly even a deny, and I just don't think Arrow have the pushing power here. DDZ and 343 will commit to it, and there's a wraparound.
TP so fast, Rage TP right now, essentially, because there's no way to get out for the Lifestealer against that Viper Strike. He goes in the open wounds, but ADTR actually holding the Viper Strike right now. He's got reinforcements, but they were unwilling to commit.
I'm surprised they played that one so passively. I think they could have afforded to be a bit more aggressive there. And Stable Concoction at the ready. Rasta's here, level 5 with all of his spells. Tied just a few creeps short of Ravage. All right.
I guess they assumed the Rage TP was just going to be the end result anyways. So yeah. They didn't feel it was relevant. I don't know.
Yeah, well, fair enough. But anyhow, it ends up being a tier 1 for tier 1 exchange. So Arrow at least finds something out of it. Glancing at net worth, it is Lifestealer who's topping the charts. About 600 gold up on the Viper in terms of net worth. Now has his face boots and another 1600 at the ready. We'll see where he goes from here, but probably Armlet Basher, pretty standard stuff will come out of the Lifestealer.
So, honestly, the Dragonite is not faring very well right now. The Viper obviously had the safe lane farm, so you expect him to do better, but, I mean, he's right now 1,700 net worth above Ketchik Imba, so the fact that DK doesn't have any real momentum outside of what his team has acquired as a whole, it is quite unfortunate for him, and it's not where you usually see a Dragonite. Dragonite's a hero who automatically gets a default number of CS, and although he has claimed 40 lives, it's not really been all that much. So he's probably going to go a very basic build himself, Drums of Endurance, maxing his Dragon's Blood to survive, that kind of stuff, because his stun is really what he contributes to the fight right now.
Mm-hmm. Well, it appears we'll have a fight break out at this bottom tier 1 tower. Invasion with a wraparound smoke, but it will get revealed. They throw down this Observer Ward, so we'll take a look at Radiant Vision right now. Void's the Initiator. Chrono out on 3. Kessick completely zoned out. It'll be a dead Shadow Shaman before the fight even starts. And they've got enough damage to dump into the Chrono that this gank from Invasion completely repelled as they rotate towards the lane. They may try a frontal assault, but things will be a little more difficult without their Shadow Shaman.
Yeah, so without a Chrono, this tower is slated to fall for sure. They have the Corrosive Breath ticking away at the tower. They could maybe go for Deny, but not worth the risk. Viper extending quite actively. They know they have the Ravage behind them, but I'm curious if they'll actually go for the tier 2 in full. Rasta's here now. They want to force Lifestealer to TP. He's been farming all game long, and they need to put him out of his comfort zone. So they are going to actually approach the tier 2. We'll see if they can take it.
Yep. Juggernaut still only level 5, so no Omni Slash for additional damage. Long cooldown on that level 1 Chrono, and Void still not really in fighting shape either. Only a Morbid Mass to go with his Power Treads and Poor Man's Shield here. Arrow kind of limited on how they can react. I like this Lifestealer split pushing, though. He will start doing some damage to this tier 2 tower. Not very quickly, but he'll start chipping away at it at least. This tier 2 in the bottom lane, though, seems destined to fall as the Corrosive Breath just ticks it down. Arrow will just let it go.
Yeah, it's a mech disadvantage. The fact that Timbersaw went for the Arcanes and the Bottle and then went for the Mechanism, and the Viper essentially just rushed it out. ADTR just brings so much more to the fight than DDZ himself, and that's going to change very shortly. Obviously, he's only 500 gold off of that Mechanism, but that few minutes where you have that 250 effective HP advantage for your entire team is pretty immense.
Yeah, absolutely. Right now, Arrow are just trying to bide their time. We see the gold graphs start to move in almost in favor of Invasion, but experience 5,000 in the lead of Arrow. So they know they're getting a lot of farm around the map. They have that late game advantage with a Void as well as a Lifestealer. So just trying to mitigate their losses for now. I think this kind of the right idea not to commit to that tier 2 tower defense, as it most likely would have been disastrous. Like you were talking about, maybe once DDZ finishes up the mech, things will change a little bit, and we'll see Arrow be more eager to take these team fights. MTR on the Juggernaut, also now hitting level 6. So even though it's only a level 1 Omni Slash at this stage in the game, still enough to solo a support if they get caught out of position.
Yeah, DDZ takes a triple stack here, so he does have the mech complete and is going to be able to actually build towards like some aggressive item, maybe the Bloodstone or something. Right now, FCFC is out of position, but the trees are not going to be what DDZ needs to get in to kill him. We're going to see Mosin drop down a sentry and kind of go for some counter warding, but they're not going to see the Observer on the high ground here.
Yeah, rather unfortunate that he gets the sentry, but not the Observer itself. How's Lifestealer doing? He did go for Armlet first, now another 800 gold up on him, but 343 continuing to impress with the farm and still maintaining his top position on the charts, and also Faceless Void now with a Mask of Badness. So some of those core items are starting to come online. What else is Invasion working on at this point? Viper doing a very standard build, mech into Ag Scepter, already has the point booster, and 2,000 gold off the remaining pieces, and Dragonite seems to be just going for the BKB, nothing crazy about that either. Ogre Club to go with his Bracer. Do you think he'll go back for the drums here or just hang on to a casual Bracer? I think it's just a casual bout of strength there.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to be the drum now that he has the Ogre Club, but it's interesting that he goes for the BKB. It doesn't really prevent all that much in this lineup. It's awesome to be the big bad dragon on the front lines, but I mean, you're really just preventing damage from Timbersaw, lift from Rubick. They don't really have any just like hard magical disables, so
yeah,
it's a half the potential impact I think it would make for a normal DK to have this timing on BKB.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. It's not going to do much against the Void or the Lifestealer, that's for damn sure. Here in the top lane, ADTR in kind of an awkward position. 3-4-3 goes forward and initiates. Zhang Zai pops forward with the Chrono, but doesn't have nearly enough damage. And now this Lifestealer caught in an awkward position. Will and Fest inside of a Radiant Creep.
The Lifestealer was caught in that, and there was no reason for him to be. Like, he had a pretty planned position as far as where he was going to be targeting, and they could have easily kept the Lifestealer on the outside hitting the Viper. But unfortunately, it doesn't work out. We'll see if the Lifestealer can still bail out here. He gets stunned before he can rage. Oh, that sucks. He's going down.
Yep. Disastrous for 3-4-3. And that was... He really didn't have any choices there. Once he got caught in the Chrono, he was committed. I think if he didn't infest right away, he would have just died. So, damned if you do, damned if you don't. Oh, man. That Chronosphere, man, it can be a double-edged sword if you're not careful. That kill will secure a Blink Dagger for the Tide, which is kind of a big deal for Invasion as they group up and pressure this top tier 1 tower. Even Rasta Wards come down, so they'll do more than pressure. They'll be able to take it. And they will actually defend their tier 1 mid as well. This is a huge victory for Invasion.
Yeah, the Ashes Spray plus Medallion combo is just chipping away at their health, that composite damage. So only two committed. The tower survives, and my goodness, have Invasion just broken this game wide open for themselves.
Yeah, Arrow's still holding on to a decent experience lead, but Invasion gaining some momentum, and now the Tide has the Blink Dagger. They can actually engage these team fights a bit easier. DDZ down bottom, all by his lonesome, could get sandwiched here as Invasion rotate. Viper will walk right into him. Viper Strike available, throws it out. And DDZ will try and TP Hone. Unstable Concoction will be there, as will the Medallion, and easy kill on the DDZ Timbersaw. And Ghost will secure it with a Gush.
So now they just have full teamfight control. If they can bring down DDZ in this stage, there's nothing to stop them from pushing in. Now they can actually make use of the Ravage with the Blink Dagger. You don't have to worry about the Rubick stealing it as much. Because you can actually just jump right on the Rubick himself. So, but like I said, as far as the draft goes, the Lifestealer, the Juggernaut are going to be relatively immune to its effects.
Blink Dagger on Dragon Knight now. So he went Bracer, Ogre Club into Blink. It's an interesting item trajectory.
It does give them that kind of initiation. I was talking about Blink for Rasta to go for the Blink Hex and stop the Lifestealer from raging, but DK Stun could do the same thing. You Blink on him, you Dragon Tail him, and if you can get a fight where Lifestealer doesn't even get to rage, that's absolutely insane. We're going to see an attempt to defend the Tier 2 mid tower, but it's a really difficult one, even with the Slow Siege.
Yeah, and there's no Glyph available either, so Corrosive Breath will tick it down a bit more. 200 hit points to spare. Radiant's Invasion will fake back and... go right back to it as they take out Cardi here and find an opportunity to engage. We've got Zhang Zai on the high ground, but there's a Radiant Ward right there. I was just about to point it out. They'll hop on him, showing off that new Blink Dagger. They even burn a Ravage for that to make sure he can't Chrono. They do secure a Deny on the tower, but it will cost them their Faceless Void. And even though they got the Deny, that's still a big access point that Dire has now lost in the mid lane.
Yeah, I'm curious if they're actually going to be committing to Rosh here. They are up against Chronosphere without Ravage, but they've got so much damage and such amount of advantage. With these wards going down, I think they're perfectly secure in this.
Yeah, and the Medallion plus wards, that is so much minus armor. Rosh will fall in a matter of seconds. Even though the Chronosphere is up, I don't think Void's going to be able to get here in time to do anything about it. Arrow will try to make a stand, though. DDZ scanning it out with the Chakram and doing a fair bit of damage. 3-4-3, now open wounds onto the Alchemist. And Omni Slash off to the side, onto the Rasta. That will be the first kill of this fight. And around the backside, Alchemist gets picked off, but Rosh falls. Viper picks up the Aegis. Alchemist will buy back into the game now that the Tidehunter's been picked off. Viper still in the pit, just clicking down the Lifestealer. He will probably lose the Aegis here, but can they do anything when he respawns is the question. Rasta Ward still in the pit, clicking him down.
Nice.
Zhang Zai now has come back and grabs two of the Chrono. FC, stuck on the other side, but does have a stun on the Void. Now Void in big trouble. DDZ coming in, caught in the shackles. Faceless Void has fallen. DDZ should go down shortly after. Viper will fall in the pit, but did a fair bit of damage before he could go down. That's the end of DDZ. It'll cost them their Shadow Shaman. It looks like Invasion will get cleaned up as Arrow regain the momentum in this fight and finish off the Alchemist. So at the end of the day, Invasion finish off Rosh and get the Aegis, but they lose it and Arrow clean it up.
Yeah, that was essentially Arrow's last stand. If they lost Roche uncontested there, that it would be very hard to come back from this game. But they swing in, they knew they had the ultimates, and their opponents did not, and they took huge advantage of that. The Chronosphere didn't look like it was doing much on the front end, but the important thing is that they allowed the two damage dealers to focus on Viper the whole time. Juggernaut and Lifestealer just hammered away at him. They brought him down. They killed the Alchemist twice, and they even take the tower as well. That was insane.
Mm-hmm. And now we see this graph really all over the place, but was moving in favor of Invasion and right back down the way of Arrow. Of course, on the Dire side, down is a good thing in context of the graph. So they'll go right back to farming. Lifestealer now with 4,500 gold at the ready. I reckon he's going to go Basher, probably into an Abyssal, but we'll see what he wants to pick up. He could possibly go for an Assault Kharos here as well if they want to start trying to cut through the armor of the Alchemist and the Dragonite. And Kesa Kimba on that Dragonite, Speak of the Devil, now on his way to the BKB, picks up the Mithril Hammer. I was starting to get a little skeptical that perhaps it would be a Halberd or an SNY or something, but nope, just made a pit stop for a Blink Dagger, and we'll go back into the Magic community.
Yep, so as far as initiation goes, it's still very well in Invasion's court. They have great effective HP on their heroes, they've got two Blink Daggers, and they certainly have the stun follow-through. But right now, Arrow, they've bought themselves some space, they have controlled most of the map, and as long as they get some good defensive wards up, they're going to be able to control their position pretty well. We have some expiring, so the supports definitely need to get on that. Otherwise, things like the smoke, it's not that you obviously won't see the smoke coming, but you don't see that all the heroes are off the map. So the Blink Stun comes out on 3-4-3, and they will get the hex, so he's going down.
Yep, he falls. His magic wand is on the ground. I think that's his magic wand. He has an Ogre Club on the Courier that almost gets picked off, but it looks like it will survive. Unless Dragonite with the Haste Rune, will he be able to finish off the Courier? Oh no! The Ogre Club, though, is actually not on the Courier anymore. Did Void get it off? Yeah, he did. Okay. So they lose their Courier, but at least he doesn't lose his item there. Or, well, not lost, but, you know,
yeah,
stuck in the Nether Realm.
Yeah, but they just lost Chronosphere for nothing. That's the worst part right there. They can just push in high ground right now.
Yeah, that's really harsh. And now the Ag Scepter is up on Viper, so Viper strikes aplenty. This will be a difficult defense. Rasta Wards come down. There is a Glyph available for the Dire side, but no Chrono or Lifestealer. They do have an Omni Slash. Suppose that's something. We'll see. Acid Spray down, completely zoning out Arrow right now. Viper Strike thrown out onto the Juggernaut. Brings the Blade Fury, but can't keep the Tier 3 tower alive. So right now, Arrow just trying to be as patient as they can. But they might be forced to watch their barracks die. 3-4-3, he's respawned, goes straight in on the Viper. And he'll get a stun straight away. The follow-up's there. Ghost throws out the Ravage. Not enough to keep the Viper alive, though. Rax are still going to fall as the wards are focusing it down. Tide has gone down. Looks like Arrow might be able to clean up this fight. Rubick has the Anchor Smash, not the Ravage. But Kesek Imba will go down. It's a 3-for-0. And a triple kill coming out for the Lifestealer. They will clean it up now with a 4th kill. And Arrow, well, it's kind of a defense. They clean up the heroes, but they lose their melee Rax.
Yeah, losing the melee Rax in the Tier 3 there, it means that it's a short-term victory. They're able to pull ahead right here and now, but in 27 seconds that won't matter nearly as much. They've got a good gold swing. They've shown what 3-4-3 can do on this Lifestealer with the Basher, the Hyperstone, the Armlet. He was doing so much physical damage, but they really need to get a long-term victory because that Rax is just going to weigh on them as the minutes go by. The drain on their economy, the general momentum towards their base being pushed in against, it's painful, and they're going to have to at least get this Tier 2 in exchange.
Yep. That Basher was absolutely huge for 3-4-3 in that fight. He opened with a bash on that Viper, I think on his second attack, and that's kind of what set the snowball rolling in favor of Arrow in terms of that defense. But they will try and claim a Tier 2 tower in the mid lane for a bit of vengeance here. Glyph comes out, as does the Acid Spray, and that's enough to repel their efforts, at least for now. They will stand on the high ground, mana up, use that healing ward, and maybe a bit of a fake back here, hoping that Invasion press forward, but they won't fall for the bait, and instead they'll head down bottom and keep that Tier 2 tower
Radiant's
safe from the creeps.
Tower is under attack.
Still here with the Lifestealer Infested inside DDZ. He's going to try to clean up the creep wave and bring down this Tier 2 quite readily. It is going to be a low commitment exchange, but now I think they're going to go in.
Yep, here we go. Zhang Zai comes flying forward. Viper seems to be the target of choice. Kesek Imba on the opposite side of it. Rasta Wards come down, doing a fair bit of damage in the middle of the fray. 3-4-3 in pretty deep. Mosin very well maybe the first to fall. Yep, down he goes. And now 3-4-3 way in deep here, and I think he'll fall all by his lonesome. The team's not even with him. he just... Him versus the world. I don't know. Went in way too far. Not much else to say about it. Now DDZ trying to TP home. He will make it. So a 2-for-0 exchange in favor of Invasion. And it was Arrow who were the aggressors there.
Yeah, it seems like there's a little bit of desperation in the eyes of Arrow. Like, they really are looking for these opportunities, and there's some potential for them to take these fights. But in general, if the Lifestealer's Rage runs out and he hasn't even killed a single person, you're not going to be able to end it successfully. So the Chronosphere wasn't bad this time around. Changzai, props for getting a really nice one off, but it wasn't, like, game-breaking. It was not allowing them to take the fight. They don't even take the Tier 2, and now they have their backs against the wall.
It feels like they just don't have enough physical damage to chop through all these tanky strength heroes. And well, even though they have the Timber Saw, it's just it's so unfortunate that he can't get in there and do any damage during the Chronosphere because he needs to be in range. So that synergy that we talked about earlier with all of these melee heroes on top of the Chronosphere is a continuing struggle for Arrow throughout this game. Juggernaut, though, is now level 11 and also has his Ag Scepter. So that's 9 bounces he'll have in this next team fight, which could make a bit of a difference.
Yeah, I think the biggest issue is that they have so much farm on Lifestealer and not much on everybody else. Like, their other kind of carry type hero, Void, is not even 7k yet. So the Lifestealer is doing great, but one Viper Strike and he's kited. Like, although I expect DDZ to be building up a Hex, I would actually prefer him to build a Lincoln Sphere and just put that Lincoln on the Lifestealer whenever he rages so that you actually do have him staying on a single target throughout the entire fight. Hard to really make work when you have blinks and ghost scepters and all this stuff to really kite you around, especially the, of course, Viper Strike, which with an Aghanim Scepter is pretty much the bane of Lifestealer's existence. But yep, you got to do something because all this farm on one hero that is half the time just spending his time running around, it's not going to really make the impact you need.
Yeah, I think you're definitely right about the itemizing, but some of it is just the decision-making as well. Even though Arrow are kind of in desperation mode, that last fight didn't really need to go the way that it did. It started at the Tier 2 tower, and Lifestealer ended up dying somewhere around down here in this area, outside of the Tier 2, just way over-committing. And he's farmed enough that I think Arrow can kind of sit back a little bit more than that, slow siege the towers, and look for a much better opportunity to engage than try and force the issue by diving Tier 2 towers. They do have some pretty solid ward coverage, though. If we take a look at the Dire Vision, they've got a nice aggressive ward down here. Well, I can't draw on the map during pauses, but they've got another one up here as well. So it's really weird that when you draw on the map during a pause, it shows up on the mini-map, but it doesn't show up on the actual map. I don't like that. Bothers
it's just one of those things. But it's like drawing the river, too. Like, I don't know why water is so weird for drawings, but like it's like...
Those graphics, dude. It's too much. But, yeah, pretty decent ward coverage for the Dire side. And even the Radiant, they've got a fair bit of ward coverage as well. One at the bottom rune, one at the entryway into their jungle. And then they've got their plateau covered here in their own jungle.
Yeah, they know they took a huge advantage with that mid lane breakdown. So that means that essentially the only thing they have to worry about not on their side of the river is Roshan. As long as they contest that kind of engagement, with the right timing, then they're perfectly fine to just sit back and farm for a little bit, because the more farm you get on a hero like the Dragonite, who had such a rough early game, is going to just give you that much more potential towards the mid to late game. And I mean, yes, Void is an insane hard carry, but right now he's not that big of a threat. Mask of Madness, soon to be a BKB, but for now, very limited in his effect.
Yeah, and also important to note that Dragonite has completed his BKB. Still at that 10-second mark, which we'll see utilized in this next team fight. MTR gets engaged upon, but will just Blade Fury TP home, and he'll be just fine. Invasion, though, living up to their name, as all five of them group up about the top lane, looking to invade the Dire Jungle, perhaps, or just pressure this top Tier 2 tower as they ping it out.
Yeah, it's interesting they put so many defensive wards out and then they're going to go for a very aggressive play, but the Tier 2 is pretty easy pickings at this point. They're very confident no matter where the enemy may be. They can have the perfect angle, the perfect flank, and I still think that Invasion take the fight, but we'll have to see as smoke movement comes out from Arrow.
Yeah, bold words from Blaze, and they will indeed try to do a wraparound here. It's a 4-hero smoke, surprise inside of the Timber Saw, and they'll try to find that angle to engage. Uh-oh, Invasion, they'll smoke up as well. It's some smoke-on-smoke action. Who will find who? Yeah, it looks like Invasion will just make the retreat, actually.
Interesting. Roche won't be spawning for a little bit. I know they're going to go back in. Okay, so it's all about the Chronosphere here. We'll see.
Yep, all about the initiation as well. DDZ, smoke gets revealed. Kessick on the high ground. They see him. He hops forward. There's the blink stun onto MTR. Chronosphere to follow up only on Kessick. They baited it out well. And there's the follow-up from Ghost. Ravage will secure the kill onto the Juggernaut. Void tries to hop away, but it's just not enough. The Dire side in big, big trouble. DDZ taking a lot of damage. 3-4-3, the only one left alive. It's a 1-for-4 swing. The Viper Strike flies, and this will be a dead lifestealer for sure. A complete team wipe, and it appears Blaze is psychic, as he called that one, to a T.
Yeah, it's tough, man. It's really tough. A Dragonite blinking in with a BKB in the front line, like, you can't manage that. You want to do something about it, but you honestly can't. Like, dropping a Chronosphere on him, the Juggernaut was caught inside Dyer's it too. He's not going to take any damage, and of course the Ravage was really Dyer's on point. Ghost blinks across the Chrono into a position where he's not inside it and gets a Ravage on a 3. Like, that's just immaculate positioning on his part, and Invasion definitely earned this win, if indeed that is what we'll be seeing. Well, obviously, it's not over till Dyer's it's over, but for now, an immense Dyer's advantage coming up for Invasion.
Yeah, absolutely, and we see the gold graph finally starting to move back in their favor, just crossing that zero threshold, and Arrow are actually still hanging on to a decent experience lead, about 4,000. The difference, though, they've lost all this momentum, and I'm not sure what's going to change that in the future. Lifestealer, his damage is getting less and less impressive as this game goes on. The net worth gap is not really growing as much as it once was. He's still working on that Assault Kuros, but seems in back-to-back team fights now, he just either gets stunned upon the initiation or just kited around by the Viper, and I'm not really sure what he can do about it. I mean, should this Lifestealer be considering a Force Staff or something at this point, just so he can hop on top of people?
I do like the old-school Blink Dagger build on the Lifestealer. That's kind of a nice way to get into things, but he's already being carried into the fights with the Timbersaw. Like, he invested in, he just absolutely destroyed Shadow Shaman once the Ghost Scepter wasn't an issue, but, like, you can get into the fight via Timbersaw, but how do you maneuver after that initial engagement? And the Force Staff, obviously, is a solution, but it's a Band-Aid fix that doesn't solve the overall problem of he can't move. He's like 100, 200 MS the entire fight, and he's going to be able to get a dozen swings at most.
Yeah, maybe a better bet at that is just going for the Abyssal. So even
you
can at least lock somebody down. If you can't move, you can lock him down next to you, and you can lay the right clicks in. But it'll be a while until that item pops out, as he has just completed the Assault Kuros. No gold on 3-4-3 right now, so of course buyback not an option. And Invasion looking to get aggressive here, as again, it's a 5-hero rotation. Invading the Dire Secret Shop, we will see Kessick pick up maybe looking into a Heart next. Yep, there's his Reaver. And they're just looking for the right angle to try and take a fight here. Ravage is available.
Yep, but it looks like at least Arrow are not going to be giving up any easy kills right now. They're moving together. They're playing it smart. Xiangzai, the only one on the outside, farming away. But they definitely do have to move as five, essentially, because if they go off one or two at a time, there's still that Blink initiation. There is no smoke, as we can see. There's only one on Shadow Shaman and none in the shop, so it just really comes down to them finding a pickoff, to be honest. But obviously, it's so difficult from this position for Arrow to actually get some offensive momentum when Invasion just moves like this. And they spot the Roshan respawn. So, yeah, this is going to be, at best, a full 5-on-5 in the pit. And at worst, Arrow just being choked out.
Yep. DDZ will go ahead and complete his Scythe of Ice now. He goes back down to the brown boots, but he has a Scythe. So this next team fight could be a little bit different now that they have a tool to lock down the Viper. If they can hex him and then hex him again before he can Viper Strike, maybe they can bring him down if they kill the Viper first and this Lifestealer runs amok. There's a chance for Arrow to take a successful team fight here, but it won't be easy. Invasion will do a 4-hero smoke, or a 5-hero smoke, pardon me, and rotate around the Rosh Pit, but they're just going to go straight up the mid. It looks like they're more interested in heroes than they are objectives at the moment. Well, I take that back. They'll rotate into Rosh.
Yeah, looking for the opportunity. As it does not present itself, they'll take the easy win. They do commit the wards here. I guess they really just don't want to take any chances, but obviously we see from our bird's eye view, Arrow is nowhere nearby. They do have the Nakes infested, so while he's not farming, he's ready to rumble, but unfortunately they're all on the back line here. This creep wave, the mega creeps continuously keeping them in their base. The Roshan and easy pickings and Invasion with just one ward CD will take it down. So ADTR has the Aegis now and two full HP bars for him.
Yeah, I like the idea to use the wards there. They had no vision of Arrow. They didn't know if they were up on the high ground ready to hop into the pit or if they were retreated into the base. So it was admittedly a bit of a gamble and lowers the risk the faster you can kill Rosh. So ended up being wasted wards, or, well, unnecessary. But I still think the idea is what counts there. They've got a gem up now, so Invasion will get a little bit of map vision. There is still no gem on the Dire, so some of those Dire wards will get cleaned up. They do ping out this ward that was thrown down, and I think they might have a sentry at the ready, or... Nope, I think they just ping out the positioning there.
Maybe. Yeah, they're looking for kills right now. Like, this is the play that Aaron needs to make if they have any chance of winning this game here, is just finding an opening. Right now, it's going to be the Dragon Knight. Can he get the BKB up before the Hex? No, it comes out, and they're going to bring him down very quickly.
Yeah, he's in big trouble. They'll try to force staff into safety. Even the Ravage comes out, but now the Tide falls. It's a 2-0 to get things started. DDZ in big trouble, though. He'll get chopped down by the Alchemist, and he'll be the first to fall on the Dire side. Viper laying in the right click, but in comes the Void. This will be enough to secure the kill on the Viper. And that procs the Aegis. Viper will be coming back up. There is an infest inside one of these Radiant creeps. Zhang Zai tries to TP home with the BKB on, but he will cancel it to turn and fight. Shadow Shaman falls as the infest bomb comes out. ADTR will make the retreat. His buddy Alchemist falls. Four of them dead on the side of Evasion. Buybacks coming out. I don't see any, but it's a disaster as Arrow take another promising team fight. One more Viper strike onto Mosin. It will secure the kill, so Viper gets somebody as he goes down, but that does not make up for a full five-man wipe and a gem on the ground as Arrow regain a lot of lost footing.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that was like a mind game from Zhang Zai where he goes for the BKB TP to bail out, but when he canceled that, essentially Invasion started committing harder to the fight. They said, okay, well, if Void's gone, we can actually win this, and that was true, but Void stayed. He had the half a BKB still running, and he was able to go in with the lifesteal and just clean house. That was absolutely impeccable from Arrow. That's exactly what they needed to. Hex onto the Dragon Knight. He didn't get that BKB off, and as tanky as he may be, they still have the tools to bring him down. I mean, a Lifestealer just feasts on that high HP hero, so really, really effective. Using that newly found Assault Cross, great value, and yeah, that is the fight they absolutely needed to stay in this game.
Yeah, and that was the first BKB charge on the Faceless Void as well, so there were a couple of shiny new items from Arrow in that fight that helped make the difference, but they just caught Dragon Knight completely off guard. Keshek was not ready for that, and as you mentioned, they were able to crowd control him and kill him before he get off the BKB, which was absolutely huge. Viper now moving into a Halberd, and I think a smart choice. The disarm, very good against Lifestealer. All he does are right clicks, so if you can stop him from doing that, then you pretty much neuter him for a good 4.5 seconds.
Yeah, and also the evasion's really good in general. It's not going to work in Chrono or if Hexed, but so far that hasn't really been too much of an issue. Zhang Zai's Chronos have been mostly focused on the frontliners, while Viper has a little bit of a distance in these fights. He likes kiting, he's a natural hunter, and he really wants to make sure that he's in a position where he can only be closed in on by the Timbersaw and by the Omnislash.
Mm-hmm. And were there any other item pickups following that successful team fight? Nope, doesn't look like it. The biggest swing was the gem. Now it is the Juggernaut who's carrying it around. And Invasion have yet to buy another one. So Arrow might be able to grab a little bit of map control here. There actually aren't too many wards down in general. That last round has pretty much expired. We see one Radiant Observer here in the bottom lane, and then there's one Dire Observer here right outside of the Secret Shop. So both teams will take a turn for the more passive. Arrow continually defending this mid lane, as you mentioned a few times. Taking a lot of their effort, but Invasion are admittedly shaken after that fight. They were a lot more aggressive maybe 5-10 minutes ago, and now they seem to be just farming around and waiting for an opportunity to present itself.
Yeah. Another big decision that will be coming up soon is Lifestealer, whether or not he wants to buy out for that Abyssal Blade in full by picking up the Sacred Relic and not having buyback gold, or if he just wants to save. In my opinion, honestly, just go big or go home. Go for that Abyssal Blade, win a fight, and shrug it off if you do get brought down. He's still level 18, he's not 25 or anything, so he will come back if he does get dropped down. I think it's very, very important that he, in fact, picks up this Abyssal, or these opportunities won't present themselves as readily.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that lockdown is going to be crucial. We saw how important it was to be able to lock down the Dragon Knight with hexes and magical stuns, but if someone gets the BKB off, having that valuable tool to lock them down through it is so huge. And especially on the Viper, if that's going to be his target of choice, if you can use that Abyssal to prevent the Viper from getting off the mech or the Heaven's Halberd, that could be a game changer in these upcoming skirmishes. Invasion, though, they've decided what they want to do, and it's push the top lane. Lifestealer will take heed to your advice, Blaze. No buyback gold available, only 400 to his name, but he's got a new Abyssal Blade.
Yeah, he's sold his mind to this. He's like, I need this now. This is the fight. And honestly, there's huge potential for Arrow to swing this back right here and now. If they can win this, they can pretty much take the game. But it's still going to be close. Invasion have been building up to this moment all game long, and they are still in fighting force with these wards on the front line.
Yep, Rasta wards come down, but Zhang Zai hops forward, goes right onto the Shadow Shaman. And he will be the first to fall. BKB popped by the Dragonite. Alchemist charging a stun off to the side. But Viper now being focused hard. And it looks like he may take a tumble. Tide comes in with the Ravage. That'll keep Viper alive for now. But now he takes a Hex. Zhang Zai falls. He buys back. Ravage stolen by the Rubick. Will help turn things around a little bit. Ghost gets obliterated as DDZ comes in. Zhang Zai rejoining the party. Hops straight on the Viper to try and zone him out. And he'll be successful in his plight. Viper takes a tumble. But it cost him their Juggernaut. Now Alchemist moves into the tower. Can 343 bring him down? One click will do it as he tries to TP home. And there's only one survivor on the side of Invasion, and it is the Dragon Knight. He'll blink to the high ground. He will TP out, but Arrow with another great hold. It didn't come for free. It did cost him the Void buyback and a death on their Juggernaut, but still a great team fight, and they keep their Tier 3 tower and Rax alive in the top lane.
Oh, that Mosin steal. Oh, my goodness. That got me so hype. He was... The tentacle wall was coming at him while the Ravage animation was playing through, and Mosin still gets a seal off in the midst of it, four staff forwards, and gets a great counterplay off. It did cost him the buyback on the Void, but well worth it to secure so many amazing kills. They are just getting so much farm on these carries now. Faceless Void even being built up into like a true carry, as he is going to be able to build up attack speed into most likely a Mjolnir long term. But for now, they're looking for this tier 2. They were seeking it out earlier, but now without a Ravage to worry about, this should be easy pickings.
Yep, a Glyph available, but they'll save it just in case Arrow try to move into the high ground here. They obviously will not do so. They'll be happy to grab that tier 2 tower, and Void will grab a cute little double stack here. So, yeah, they get rewarded for their aggression, and they, well, all right, they take one Thunderhide, but still, thought they would have at least cleared out that stack. But risky. They had no vision on Invasion, no ward coverage, so they won't hang around too long. Invasion will do a 5-hero smoke once again, and it appears they have these bottom two heroes set in their Mosin and MTR. Could find themselves in a bit of a pickle here in the upcoming moments.
Yeah, I think Mosin really just needs to fall back and make sure he gets his Ravage off for the second time. He has a long duration steal, the second point is ultimate, so he can have this be a real impact. And no BKB piercing disable means a spin TP will just get them out of dodge 100%. So, like, Invasion want to be offensive, but they know that the Ravage cooldown of the Rubick is pretty much cooling down with their own. Ghost has his up in 13, so they know maybe 5 seconds later that's going to be for Mosin. And it's how impactful that steal is. If Mosin could survive through a fight with that Ravage available, like, it essentially stops Invasion from actually finishing this game.
Yep, and it has cooled down on both sides of the coin, so breaking the high ground now from Invasion will be that much more difficult. They did decent damage to the Tier 3 tower in the top lane, got it below half health. So the Rasta wards alone can sort of slow siege if they continue to shove in, but there are only so many times that they can get wiped up for half damage on a tower before it just becomes too much, and Arrow can cripple their base on the revenge push, as it were. Next Rosh will be coming up before too long here. Looks like about a minute and a half on this next Roshan. 343 scouting it out just in case it was a quick respawn. But we may see both teams be a little more passive until Rosh does come back up. Also, a Blink Dagger now on the Juggernaut to follow his Aghanim Scepter and Casual Morbid Mask.
Yeah. One thing I want to note is how effective Ravage is on the side of Arrow as opposed to Invasion. Right now, there's a BKB on the Timbersaw on the Void, there's Spin on the Juggernaut, and Rage on the Lifestealer. Four heroes are completely unaffected by Ravage during a certain period of time, whereas on the other side, Dragonite's the only one that's immune. So Mosin has so much more potential than the Tidehunter to pull it off. The Tide last time around, Ghost was very, very patient, but if you get it stolen and it just nullifies everything you've tried to accomplish so far. So we do see initiation onto Lifesteal. He'll be able to infest out, but they're just camping this Roshan. 20 seconds, and oh my gosh.
Oh no, Zhang Zai was ready to initiate. There's the Ravage from Mosin, but right back at you coming from Ghost. Looks like the Void may take a tumble, manages to get off the Chronosphere, but traps his Juggernaut inside. Now 343 chops down the Tidehunter as he was caught on the side of the Ravage. It will cost him their Juggernaut. Rasta wards come down right on top of the Lifestealer. The rest of Arrow coming forward. DDZ ready to drop the hammer. Rasta wards now stolen by Mosin, and that'll help turn the tides. It does cost him their Lifestealer, though. Viper taking a lot of damage. It's kinky down here. Ward on ward action as now DDZ on the retreat, and it's Arrow that's actually going to get cleaned up. DDZ will try to TP home. He'll get stunned, and he will fall. It's a 1-for-3 trade. Let's take a look at the buybacks. Already been burned by the Timbersaw. He's ready to get back in the action. Void, he's still alive, but his buyback is still on cooldown from the last fight. Glyph available on the Dire side, but Invasion will go for this top lane of Rax straight away.
Are they trying to fight through backdoor production? I'm not too sure. Like, he keeps hammering at the tier 3. That thing's not going down. But DDZ is taking some big hits here. Right-clicking down the stun, and DDZ goes down.
Oh, no. That's a dieback for DDZ. Zhang Zai goes in, but he doesn't have an ultimate. This should be a dead void right here. No time walk either. He time walked in with no escape plan or BKB. It's just a straight feed, and now invasion. They'll get a free lane of Rax, and that's it. Arrow have had enough, and they will tap out. GG, well played. Invasion take game one of this best of three series.
Yeah, losing the lifestealer without buyback there is what sealed the deal. But Bozen, even in their death throes, just pulled off some incredible plays, throwing out his Ravage even before the Tide got the chance to, and then stealing wards as well as escaping from that fight with a nice four staff into the pit. Like, Moza played out of his mind, and I have to give him the at least late game MVP. Pretty quiet until that point, but certainly let sparks fly once it really came down to it. Unfortunately, it wasn't enough. Lifestealer, Faceless Void, they weren't able to outcarry their opposition invasion, pull ahead, and yeah, this is already looking to be an amazing match.
Yeah. Certainly a fun series so far, a very back-and-forth game. We looked at the graph quite a bit, but it was up and down and all over the place. That was only game one, guys. Again, Invasion, take it, but we'll move into game two after this short break between Arrow and Invasion. Can Invasion take a 2-0 sweep to move into the next round, or will Arrow tie it up and take us into an ace match? You'll have to be a little patient and come back in a few minutes to find out.